magic. Hi guys, how you doing? Nick Jennison and Connor Thomas. Hooray for Guitar Interactive Magazine GI Plus. It's Monday evening. We're doing the thing that we do on Monday evenings, which is hang out and talk about the guitar. Specifically, Connor and I are hanging out. This feels weird hanging out like at separate studios, considering we're only half an hour away from each other. But you know, we were just kind of talking about this off camera, you guys, before we went on. We're talking about how like we feel like the different studio environments kind of like they kind of reflect us to a degree. You kind of sat there in this this wonderful organic space with wood walls and like beams and all that sort of thing, and here's me just surrounded by amps. But yeah, it's funny. I like it. I'm a fan. But we're talking about amps today, but we're talking about acoustic amps rather, very specifically. We'll get onto that in a little bit. But first of all, to my friends who are tuning in case you're wondering what's going on, hi, how are you doing? It's great to have you on board. It's Monday evening. We do a stream on this channel every Monday evening where we talk about all manner of different things guitar related. It's usually educational in nature, and today is no exception, although it's kind of some gear education today, which I am down for. Now, the topic came up when we were discussing some stuff with our good friends from Fishman, who have been kind enough to bring you this stream. They're this evening's sponsors, about the subject of acoustic amps. And I'm like, listen, I don't really understand acoustic amps. I don't really get... I mean, I can work them, I can turn them on, I can plug them into them, and that's fine, but I'm like, I don't really get what they're about, but I know a man who does. So you guys have all met Connor before. Connor's been on a previous stream. He's going to be doing a bunch of stuff for GI going forward, including but not limited to some excellent tech sessions that I've had a little preview of, and they are chef's kiss. But anyway, just a quick reintroduction. If you are joining us for the first time, we do this every Monday evening. If you're one of our returning streamers, it is great to have you back on board. We'll check in with you guys in a minute. Before we do, Connor, how you doing? Say hello to everyone. Magic. So let's just take a quick second before we get into the full flow of what we're doing today and just say hi to the folks that are in the stream. We've got some of our regulars. We've got some new friends, some old friends. Marcin was, of course, the first one through the door at... what time was Marcin here? It's... let's see. Oh, yeah. 3:48 p.m. So Marcin's been here for hours. Marcin is always first. But, like, great guitar player, friend of the stream, one of our regulars. Lovely to have him in. Sacred Godslayer, our metal correspondent, is here. Says, hi, Marcin. Hi, guys. Hi, Nick. Hi, Connor. Sacred Godslayer, good to have you. Connor Thomas is here. Well, what are the odds? There we go. It's like Connorception. PJ is in the house. Response Audio is here. Hope you're all having a great Monday. I am indeed having a great Monday because Connor's here to do the heavy lifting, and I always marvel at Connor's guitar playing. So you guys know that I dabble in the guitars with holes in them, but there's a big difference between being a dabbler and being an expert. So we got a man in for this one. Timothy Appling is here. I keep saying Timothy Appling's name wrong because I read things in haste. So I keep calling Timothy Appalling, which I think is a great name for like a punk stage name, like a Sid Vicious kind of thing, like Timothy Appalling. I'm like, yeah. Incidentally, by the way, in case anybody's got any suggestions, my friend Liam is looking for a he's looking for a great name for a really horrible death metal band that he's starting, and at the minute he has Beyond Awful, which I think is pretty good, but I think there are better ones out there. I heard Spinal Headache the other day, which is like apparently a medical condition. It's like, yeah, me neither, man. Like, and I can't read them. So, yeah. Anyway, David Yates in the house. David, it's really good to see you. Larry Warren is here. Oh, man, Larry Warren has been down with the Rona. I'm glad he's feeling better, man. It's no joke, right? It nearly topped me off the two times I've had it. It was awful. I was bedbound. Just horrendous. So I'm glad he's feeling better, man. Timothy Appling says, glad to hear it. Glad it was a mild case. My dad barely made through a bad COVID a few weeks ago. Yeah, it's still bad. It's no joke, man. Not to be messed with. So who else do we have in the house? Let's say hello to Helmet Strap. Helmet Strap's really good to have you. Larry Warren says he's tried the Fender Acoustasonic. I tried the Tonewood thing where without an amp, it can go on the back of the guitar. Both did the trick for me. Now, Connor, you're a bit of a Tonewood amp connoisseur, right? So you're like Mr. Tonewood amp. Hmm. Yeah, well, we're about to find out because we've got the Loudbox Mini on the desk. We'll get to that in a second. It's going to be our amp of choice today. So other amps are, of course, available, but I do like the Loudbox. Now, again, when I've played with these, I'm like, yeah, this is cool. I don't know why I want one, but it sounds really good. But we're going to figure that out between us. But yeah, man, the Tonewood amp thing's killer. I remember when you were studying at a college I was teaching at, and like you put it on the vending machine or something like that and played, and the whole vending machine became an amp. I'm like, right, this is pretty wild. But this is also when we first had the discussion about acoustic amps, and I had my mind gently blown. I'm like, why have you got an amp with you? Like, you know, we got PA systems here. And you're like, Yeah. Anyway, we'll see a couple more. For sure, man. A couple of very more quick hellos. Steve McDee's in the house. Steve McDee had COVID as well. Everybody's getting ill, right? I know it is the season to be poorly, but I'm glad you're feeling better, Steve. Here we go. Steve McDee says, if you play like Connor, you probably don't need an acoustic amp. I need all the help I can get. I don't know about you, man. I feel like the acoustic amp is probably... it's probably even more important when you get to your kind of level because of the things that it does. We've got a thumbs up bubble. That was that's some very impressive tech. Is that something happening at your end? I don't know what's going on there, but it's pretty cool. We'll have it. Who else do we have in the house? Foghorn is just here. Cranky Tom is tuning in. I'm guessing from Germany. Who knows? Travels all over the world. Timothy Appling says, great playing, Connor. Can confirm. Incredible playing, says David Yates, for sure. Jonathan Graham says, anal bead is my band name suggestion, no charge. If it's not charged, is it any good? Yeah, it's a quite a visual. We're doing civilized guitars here today, John. It's the guitars with the holes in them. Anyway, so without further ado, let's get stuck into the meat of today's session. So, Connor, you've got an amp sat next to you, which is the new Fishman Loudbox. The new Fishman Loudbox Mini. Now, I took a look at the original Loudbox when it first came out. The Mini is, surprise, surprise, the same, only smaller. You've used a bunch of amps over the years. Can you tell us a little bit about your first impressions of the Loudbox? Because I dropped it off at your house yesterday. Yeah. Nice, very cool. Well, I mean, I guess this. Can we take a look at it? By the way, you've got a camera on it. Can we see it? Yeah. Oh, if I solo you, yeah. Look at that. Yeah. Right. Right, yeah, that is pretty low. Yeah, I mean, yeah, it's so, in terms of how we're hearing it, so what are we actually listening to now? So we're hearing the, Yeah. Mm. Right. Oh, yeah, that's nice. Yeah, really nice. Sweet. I mean, it sounds absolutely fabulous. Like really, really great. So I guess this leads me to the burning question of the day, right? Which is, okay, so I, like many primarily electric guitar players. In fact, I'm just going to call myself an electric guitar player. I don't really, this is something that I'm ashamed of, but I don't even own a good working acoustic guitar. This is a long-term loan. The ones on the wall are long-term loans. I've needed them for gigs, and I've needed to borrow them in the past. But for me, it's electric guitars, and as you can see, it's a whole bunch of valve amps. So I like valve amps because they're kind of part of the ecosystem of the guitar. The guitar is, with the electric guitar at least, it's pretty boring on its own. It sounds pretty rubbish. You play it unplugged, it sounds like nothing. If you play it into just a straight DI, so you plug into a PA system or something, it also sounds really boring. The amp is really as much a part of the tone as the guitar is, I think. But whenever I've played out with acoustic guitars, I've either sat, and this is me being just ignorant here, this is my own lack of knowledge on this subject. I have either just played them unplugged in the house and just played them, hey, this sounds nice, or if I'm writing a song with somebody or whatever. And then when I'm gigging, it's like go into the DI box, go into the PA system, and then have it come back through foldback. So I was always a little confused as to what the acoustic amp is for, because when I've played them, I've enjoyed them. But I'm like, what's the deal with that? Because, like, not to get all Seinfeld, like, what's the deal with acoustic amps? But I've always kind of like struggled to kind of get my head around why you would need one. Like, what is this for? Surely you can just plug in, go to the house, or if you're playing on your own, just. I realize, having spoken to you, that I am wrong. So, like, tell us about acoustic amps, man. Like, what are they for? Why do you use them? Why should somebody be interested in using them? Interesting. Interesting. That's really interesting. Right away, like, that's not an application I would have considered. So for me, I would have been like, well, why bother? Just go into the PA. But this is my ignorance speaking, because of course you wouldn't do that with an electric guitar. You would never like take a distortion pedal and run it into a desk. You know, maybe you would take something purpose designed for that, but that's literally what you're saying. So, and I guess probably a better comparison is maybe a bass, because we tend to play bass without all of the distortion and sound mangling that goes along. Tend to, it's not always true, but you know, a lot of bass players do play very clean. But even still, it's not terribly common just to DI a bass in the PA recording. Sure. Now this is interesting. So, like, in your experience, what's the difference between you having the preamplifier and not, in terms of the sound and the feel? Let's just highlight that there real quick. Interesting. I would have thought that would have been the last thing you'd want for artificial harmonics. I would have thought it would have been like maybe a treble thing because they're so high, but you need mid-range for that. That's interesting. Can you, just for our guys who are watching, can you show us the artificial harmonics thing in case anybody missed that or... Well, now, I mean, first of all, that's absolutely friggin' marvelous. And you guys who want to learn that sort of stuff, we have a Tommy Emmanuel tech session, which is coming very soon. Now, Connor, you have, we'll not get into this today. This is another story for another day. You have a bit of a personal history with Tommy. That sounds like you like fought or something, with the way I put it there. It came out wrong in my head. But you and Tommy are pals. You know, you've played together, all sort of thing. We'll get into that another time. So if you want to learn the Tommy thing, we got you covered. It's coming. But one from Sacred Godslayer, which I also wanted to ask, he wants to know, and I also want to know, what's the difference between having the mids set right for the artificial harmonics and not? Like, can you show us it with the mids and without the mids? Yeah, definitely. Yeah. All right. Yeah. Oh, wow. Yeah, I can hear that big time. And our guys in the comments can too. Sacred Godslayer says, woo, much fuller. Totally agree. Let a PJ... Right. Mm. that's really interesting, because that is not, it's, I mean, Larry Warren says, I've learned something. I've learned something too, because I would not that I can do the artificial harmonics thing to anywhere near your standard, but, so the guitar I have sitting with me right now, it has a Fishman, oh, I can't remember what system it is, but it has a Fishman pickup system in it, and it has this kind of, almost like a mids to scooped kind of control. And for me, I was always kind of sat thinking, I'll just show you guys real quick. So I think we're on the fully scooped setting right now. If we turn it all the way to the fully MIDI setting, fully scooped. And for me, did you hear that okay? Yeah, nice. So for me, I was always kind of under the impression of like, well, why would you ever want the fully mids thing? Because it sounds pretty, like you say, pretty honky and pretty congested a lot of the time. I've used it if I've had to take a lead break before. But even then, it's like, I like the sound of the scoop a little better. But that was really interesting because I didn't expect the... I didn't expect what I got. Like, I was expecting the scoop would give the prettiness to the harmonics, but in actual fact, you end up with just more, I guess, more string clunk and finger noise than actual note. Whereas if you turn the mid-range up, the note comes through really, really clean. So, yeah, okay, so I've already learned something. Right. Yeah, it's one thing to take to the gig. You don't need to worry about like setting up a pedal board if you don't want to. Or now this actually, you know what it is? Like, there's a parallel here because I've often had the question of to know why when I play live with my electric, why do I boost my own solos? So I have a pedal. I hit it. It gives me the loud, and then. You know, it's like, well, why not just let the sound man boost your solos? And I'm like, because the sound man will miss the first two bars of the solo if they get it at all, because they're worried about the vocalist, you know, and that's the right thing to be worried about. They're worried about, is the vocal good? Because that's the song. Is the kick drum and snare drum sounding good? Because that's what we're dancing to. The guitar guy, hairy guy in the corner, it's like, yeah, you're there. making sure you're not killing everybody with 3K, and then we're good. So, I guess it's the same deal where, you know, if you have a song where you need a particular volume level, if you're going to be playing something delicate and fingerstyle-y and then you've been playing something really aggressive with a flat pick, on the next song, you can just not take everybody's head off for the first... Because that's really interesting. Really interesting. Right. Interesting. Yeah. That I can believe, but I never would have considered that. So that's really interesting. I don't know why I assumed the goal of the acoustic amp would just be to take what you're putting into it and give it out to you as accurately as possible. But obviously that's not the case. It's not a fully flat, fully clean thing. So is there a feel difference? Is there some compression going on there or something? Or mm. That's a good point. Right. And I'm guessing that must be something, because you've obviously done all manner of shows and all manner of places over the years. Is that that'll be something you've bumped up against, I'd imagine, then. Right. Nice. Yeah, familiar with that. It's normally, the little silver Behringer box that's had beer poured into it and stuff. And even if you get a nice, like a nice industry standard DI, it's not designed to be flattering. It's designed just to be accurate, and that might not be what we're going for. So that is really interesting. So, Timothy Appling's asking the question, says, so your treble middle bass controls and other controls you have in the amp are sent to your front of house with this amp. I think that's the case with most amps, right? Yeah. Big problem. Nice. Nice. Oh, there we go. Oh, yeah. Right. So that acts like a personal monitor. So you can kind of like turn that up. If you say, for example, you've got I don't know. Let's say, for example, you're playing as part of an ensemble, and there is a limited number of monitors available. You maybe don't get you don't get the luxury of having one of your own, or you maybe don't get the full attention of the monitor engineer. You can just go more me. And there we go. That's really interesting. So this raises the question then. So this is something Jonathan's asked about, and it's something that you spoke to me on, which kind of blew my little mind on this, was the way that the amp's volume affects the way the guitar plays. So Jonathan's saying, says, does how hot the amp is play a part of how you play live? Can certainly make such a difference on the electric side of things, and even for vocals. Can definitely confirm. So I just speaking about my own live system. So I use a modeler live because I have to get up on an airplane, and I'll use in-ears, especially when I'm singing. It'll be in-ears, but I still have monitors throwing my guitar at me because there's something about that feeling of power that you get from having the rumble of the guitar and the way the guitar interacts with the sound. We take that for granted as electric guitar players and as vocalists too. You feel the power and the weight of your voice when you sing. It makes a difference. You don't push as hard. I didn't think this was a deal with acoustic guitars because you're not really using it the same way you would an electric guitar, where you want that long distorted sustain, for example, or But then we discussed this, and you were like, no, let me show you what a difference it makes. And I was staggered. So tell us a bit about the stage volume and how that affects things. Right. That's interesting. So, wait a minute. So, not putting as much pressure on the top of the guitar, like, what's the deal with that? Okay. Maybe like take it, yeah, maybe like play something and then like take the arm on and off. I think it's just tuning, but I can confirm. It's hard to tell in the DI for sure, but I can definitely confirm that. First of all, it was a piece of advice that was given to me by a really great older guitar player who was like, "Don't dampen the guitar's top. This is a big speaker, essentially. This is the speaker in your speaker cab. And if you sit like this, like John Petrucci, not John Petrucci playing acoustic, but playing the electric, where everything's locked in, it's like it might feel great, but you're gonna deaden the sound." And I've definitely had that experience myself. So is that something? Go on. No, go for it. Oh. Oh, you can definitely hear it there. Definitely hear it there. Right. Wow. That's interesting. So could you maybe turn the amp up and show us an example? Oh yeah. But the guitar's still. No, you can hear that. You can hear the difference. So. Yeah. Something's telling me you've done this. You've done the drop in the logic and have a look at the, yeah, that's sort of thing I would do. So yeah. Right. Oh, interesting. Well, before we get to that, like, because there's going to be a difference there. So, like, in a live situation, then, when would you use feedback? Like, what would you use it for? Ah, nice. Right, that makes sense. And is that something where you would you'd like move yourself to different positions relative to the amp? So maybe put like the X on the stage. Well, now that was a question that's coming from Jonathan about that. Says, am I right in thinking Tommy always has his amp set to the point of feedback, or maybe I'm just thinking the mic's up full blast? I mean, you know, you. Yeah. Oh. Yeah. Okay. That's interesting. And does that, so what does that do when you're left with all that bass? Yeah, interesting. Right. Now that makes a lot of sense. Now, does it affect? I'm gonna say how easy it is to play certain things. So one of the things I've noticed with playing the acoustic is it can be pretty punishing for certain techniques. You know, a lot of things are fine. You know, if your chops are together, you can translate a lot of what I do on the electric over to the acoustic. But there are some things specifically, where I'm relying on the compression of the amp to make things pop out. Like, let's say, like a lot of hammer-ons and pull-offs, for example, where if I'm doing long runs, let's say, they just run out of energy and the notes become absolutely tiny on the acoustic. Does the feedback like help with that? Is that something that makes it easier to play, or? Right. Yeah, it becomes enormous. Well, that leads us to the next point, doesn't it? Just want to say a couple of quick little bits of housekeeping before we go. If you want to learn some of these techniques that we're talking about, you can check out Connor's Tommy Emmanuel tech session in the latest edition of Guitar Interactive. Can you believe we're up to 100 issues? Issue 100, man, and you got to be the 100, man. It's pretty cool. Hey, you know. It couldn't happen to a nicer and more deserving guy, let me tell you. But Jonathan also says regarding guitar, says there's no amps there. You see, well, that's because some guy keeps buying all the Bogners and taking them home on the bus. So that's an in joke. We'll talk about that another time. So anyway, on the subject of practicing for gigs. So tell me about that, because this is something that. I've noticed with, and I don't want to throw mud at people here because, you know, everybody's at different stages in the guitar playing journey, but something I've noticed is you find a lot of very good guitar players who maybe don't gig will struggle very badly with a loud amp on stage with the electric. So they'll struggle to control it in the sense that, you know, when you're playing in a very controlled environment and the volume is low, it's a very different beast compared to when you play at full stage volume. It feels different. It psychologically it's different, but also you need to control the amp and control the noise. And one of the tells that I can always spot is when you see somebody playing, if they finish a phrase, this is an electric player, and they do this with the volume, you go, that's somebody who plays live. If they do this at the end of a phrase, you go, you don't, because that's not going to do anything. That's like, if I'm playing through a loud, high-gain valve amp and I go like this, with the best will in the world, it's either going to go, or it's going to go, beep, one or the other. The strings won't move, but the amp's going to do some stuff. Whereas if I do that, it's off. So I've never considered that this sort of thing might be important for acoustic guitar. Tell me about it. Tell me what's going on there. Now, why is that? That's an interesting one, because I've had a bass player friend of mine say the same, and he is a fabulous bass player, and it is one of his sayings that he comes out with all the time is to let the amp do the work, and just like, you know, he plays very lightly. Even his slap and pop technique is very light. So why is that? Tell me what the deal is with playing lighter when you're plugged in. Mm. Could you demonstrate some of that? Could you? Yeah. Ah, we're fine. Yeah, without all the assistance. Yeah. That sounds loads better. That's fascinating. Now, that's interesting because the amplified sound that we're hearing, it didn't really make a difference in terms of the volume, but the tone was wildly different. So, you know, it sounded kind of, dare I say, it sounded a little bit amateurish with the first example. It didn't have that slickness that I'm used to hearing from you, where everything's just sounds really, really sweet. It's easy to attribute that to the guitar, but obviously technique makes a huge difference here. And, you know, like having your playing technique in the sweet spot dynamically and being able to do that because the amp is getting you to the appropriate level of volume, it's a little bit like singing. You know, it's the same sort of deal where there are certain sounds that might not be the loudest sound you can make, but is maybe the nicest sounding sound that you can make, and you let the microphone do the work. I've never thought about that before. That's really, really, I mean, this is fascinating stuff. Yeah, it sounds ridiculous. Yeah. So with that in mind then, so I just want to kind of like zoom a little bit out there with the big picture sort of thing. So would you play differently in that case if you were playing in a plug? Let's say you're playing the same piece. You're doing classical gas and you're doing it in the morning. You're doing it in a studio with lovely vintage condenser mics around you. And then in the evening, you're going out and you're playing it on stage. Would you play differently in that mic'd up, unplugged environment versus that plugged in kind of setting? And how? In which situation? In the live situation? Mm. That's interesting. That leads me on to another question I had, which is like when you're doing this, when you're setting up an acoustic guitar sound, are you trying to get the sound of the guitar unplugged only loud, or are you actually going for a different thing entirely? The reason I asked this is we recently had a number of Takamine guitars in for review, and they had a bunch of preamps in them that were deliberately not very natural sounding, and they had that kind of like late 70s, early 80s stadium rock strummed sound about them, where it is a bit compressed and a bit ack kind of, but it's cool. Is that, what are you going for with that? Are you going for the natural representation of the guitar, or are you going for something different or somewhere in between? Right. No, it really wasn't, man. It was a very detailed way of answering, and that's what I want. You know, I wanted to know. So, because it's like one of these deals where I would have, I mean, this is true in so many, musical endeavors, where you try and get the result of this only louder, let's say, but you have to jump through so many hoops to get it. You can't just go, well, just plug it into the thing and then it's done. It's really pretty wild. We've got some great questions coming in. I'm aware that we've just waffled, or I've just waffled, and you've given us some great information for but that's fine. I'm here for it, man. But we're going to go to some questions because we've got a few of them. I could sit and talk about this with you all day because I've learned so much stuff. We've had this conversation before a few times, and every time I come away going, oh yeah, that's really interesting. So I want to start with this one. This is one from PJ. Says, stupid question, guys. There are no stupid questions, right? These, if you ask the question because you honestly want to know the answer, there are no stupid questions. Says, why not use a run-of-the-mill JCM800 into a 4x12? I have an opinion on this, and I'm sure you have a much more informed one. So, yeah, it is. So JCM800 is these gold panel guys over this shoulder. These are Victory's take on the JCM800. JCM800 is a Marshall amplifier. In fact, what am I doing? I have kicking around down here. I can't plug it in yet, unfortunately. But if I move my body in just such a way, we have a tiny JCM800 lurking down here. So basically, the deal is it's a Marshall amplifier. It's a classic. It's an all-time classic rock amp. Now, the reason we wouldn't use this is because, and I think I'm halfway to the truth here. So I would have said the reason we wouldn't use this is the same reason you wouldn't sing through one, is because the JCM800 is not flat response in terms of not being, it has distortion baked into it. So it's not linear dynamically, but it's also has a very pronounced kind of contour in terms of the mid-range, but then you also have a 4x12, which is also not flat response, in that it rolls off everything above like 6k, and then, you know, sometimes even 5k, and even then there's a real big kind of like contour in the mid-range, so it's not full range, it's not flat response. However, I think that's part of the reason, but we've learned today that full range and flat response is not actually what you want with an acoustic amp, right? So you tell me. Mm.
Oh, yeah.
It's basically zero. Okay. Right. Yeah, come around. I've got plenty of them. So, you know, I have all the amps from guitar, apparently. Yeah, that's, you know what? I didn't even consider that. So I was just considering the sound. I'm like, oh, it's not going to sound right. But there's obviously that response thing. I wouldn't have even considered that. I would have just went, well, yeah, it's not going to sound right, so you wouldn't use it. But the instant feedback thing, of course you would. We get feedback with like semi-hollow guitars through a JCM 800, never mind a guitar with a big hole in the middle. So that's, yeah, there you go. So that's why, PJ. I think so. Is there a circumstance when you would go for some distortion? Oh, yeah. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Nice. I think we lost Connor there. The copyright gods have gone and got him. Are you still with us? Yeah, it's my daughter's lawyer is in charge of the internet, and he's like, don't give away the trade secrets. So he's like, oh, yeah. But I mean, it's really interesting that it's through one of the pickup systems. So I mean, I guess if you have like multiple channels on an amp, that might be another thing you could play with. Right. That makes sense. That makes a lot of sense. Because I've played a few acoustics with those magnetic pickups, like the little guy that lives here. And you know, there are some sound hole pickups that sound great. The magnetic ones, they just sound like an electric. It's like a Telecaster, only less Telecastery. To that end, I have a question from the best username, Dead Man Doogie Van Dugesen, says, question mark, my D28 and 67 J45, there's a flex, don't have electronics. How might I mic them? I'm guessing how might you amplify them through the Fishman? Any ideas on how you might do maybe an amplified gig? Oh yeah, go for it. Go for it, go for it, go for it. So yeah, if you've got any questions to this end, guys, we're still taking questions. If you have any more, drop them down below, because this is something I'm interested to hear. Here's a comment from PJ. It says, yeah. That's pretty cool. So if you have those lovely vintage acoustic guitars that obviously you don't want to take a drill to, I wouldn't want to take a drill to a 60s Gibson acoustic, you know. That's really cool. That is very cool. However, I would also say they sound like really lovely guitars, and you might want to keep them in the house and maybe get something a bit more gig worthy. Doogie Van Dugerson. However, if you want to bring them to my house, that's cool. I'll play them. Yeah, dude. Have you played any of the what are they now? They're not. Oh, it's the ones that are they released this year. They're like a true historic kind of deal. I can't remember. I'm blanking on what they're called. We played them at NAMM and they were absolutely mind-blowing. They're like the like exact recreations of the I don't know if it's them, but all I remember is there was a D28 and a D18, and they were really expensive, and they were fantastic. They were fantastic. Jonathan says, "Here says the man dragging a Maiden around the country." Yeah, those Maiden guitars are no joke, right? Yeah. Can you show that to the camera real quick? Because we were talking about this. We were talking about how gear. This is just off camera. Talking about how gear can elevate you as a player. And we, I was talking about my old Ibanez. We're gonna get old guitars out here. So I was talking about my old Ibanez that I learned on, which was in mint condition when I got it. And Connor's like, "Oh, I got a Maiden like that." Like, "Oh, dude, wow." So. That's no mean feat. That's interesting. Right. Ah, now that is an interesting thing because you've told me about those McLaren guitars before. That's is it Sam McLaren? It's yeah, and that's a guy, a friend of yours, and he builds the guitars, and they're really, really great. I've had the fortune of playing one of them, and it was tremendous. Like it's like a piano. Like, you play the thing, you play the low E string, and it's so nice. But this is something that you maybe would reach more for recording, I'm guessing. Right. Of course. That's really interesting. Now, again, I would never have considered that. Like, not even in a zillion years. I'd be like, it's an acoustic guitar. They're different, and we appreciate that, different types of guitars and different body styles and all that have different sounds. But I never would have considered, oh yeah, you've got this one for an app. But this one. It's ironic because I have a Godan multi-ack, just literally off camera, which is a stage nylon. It makes almost no sound, but it sounds tremendous plugged in. That's really interesting stuff. I could get up into the weeds about this all day, but unfortunately, We have run out of time. So a little bit of housekeeping before we go. First of all, very quickly, our last question, not so much a question, but a request from a man, Jonathan. Jonathan's asking if we can hear Human Nature. Maybe to play us out on. We'll give you a second to think about that. He's just ready to go at the drop of a hat, man. Like, if you ask me to play a song, I'm like, I don't know songs. Because, you know, or I know the guitar part to... a song that, you know, was played by a 10-piece soul band. I'm like, yeah, I can play you it, but it won't be very interesting. But, you know, you put together these fabulous arrangements where you've got literally everything. You have the harmony, you've got some percussion stuff, you've got the... Oh, it's just tremendous, right? It's like, oh man, Connor's actually playing music instead of just playing loads of notes. So a little bit of housekeeping then before we go. First of all, guys... thank you so much for joining us. I've had a great time. We're looking forward to doing some more of these with Connor over the coming weeks and months. Also, don't forget, if you want to learn his Tommy Emmanuel tech session, which is absolutely excellent, you can check that out in the current edition of Guitar Interactive Magazine, which is issue 100, available at guitarinteractivemagazine.com. Go there, get the issue. There's loads of good stuff in there. Also, again, you can check out Connor's tech session. It's wonderful. You got some more coming in the next few months. Really looking forward to see them. We're going to let Connor play us out. Guys, thank you so much for having us. I will see you guys same time next week. And Connor, I'll catch you in about 5 minutes after we're done with this, and we'll carry on this conversation. But yeah, for the time being, my name is Nick Jennison. This is Connor Thomas. He's going to play some wonderful guitar. I'll see you guys next week.